If you have not already, I ask you to please take your seats. We're going to start our program here in just a moment. I'll just do a couple real quick housekeeping things before we get started. I'll try and remind you later, but there's a good chance I'll forget. So as long as I'm thinking about it now. We'll just have a couple pieces before we get started for dinner. For dinner, I would ask when you get up to get your food, please wear your mask to get your food and then return to your table. You can moan and groan. We're just trying to help out the staff here so they don't have to yell at us. So I ask you to be cooperative with them. Thank you very much for that. It is a great day despite the 18-degree weather. We did have sunshine today, so if there was no snow on the field, you guys probably could have worked out today outside, but the snow's on the field. But it's a beautiful day and a great day like this to always think about baseball. As to get things started today, it's my pleasure to introduce the Director of Athletics for Niagara University, Mr. Simon Gray. Simon?
Thank you, Tom. Those who speak before dinner really have no chance. So if you'll just bear with me for a couple minutes, and then we'll move on to the dinner portion. But first of all, I want to thank Tom for being our MC tonight. Tom is a very influential leader on our campus and just a tremendous supporter of Division I athletics. And Tom, we thank you for your time. He's also the person who gets to communicate when there are snow days on campus. So he's either incredibly popular or not at all, you know, depending on the decision that's made. But Tom, do appreciate you being here. So last week I was at a conference in Florida for our Athletic Directors Association, and those of you that know Bill Bradshaw wouldn't be surprised that I was at a reception when I ran into him. So Bill was the former athletic director at Temple and DePaul and LaSalle, but he got his start at Niagara as a baseball coach. And he's just a phenomenal person, dynamic personality, obviously had a great career. I see Ed Warnke over here. He knows Bill very well. He was young when he coached here. But when we were at this reception and talking, Niagara baseball came up, right? And so we were talking about Frank Layden. So Frank Layden, you guys probably don't know Frank Layden, but he was an NBA coach for the Utah Jazz, and then he was in the front office for them for a long time. And one of the best Niagara, bleeds purple, one of the best Niagara fans out there. But when Frank was here in the early 50s, he was also here with Hubie Brown. So you may know Hubie. He's now the ESPN commentator calling the NBA games on ESPN. And there was another gentleman who was here named Larry Costello. So they all played basketball, and they all ended up being NBA coaches. And they all played baseball at Niagara University. And if you ask them, I'm pretty sure when they ask them what their number one love is, it's baseball, right? So it started in the 50s all the way through Bill Bradshaw, Ed Warnke. We have a lot of alums here tonight, and now it's you guys, right? So there's a famous line in one of the movies that's the one constant that we have is what? Baseball, right? The one constant, baseball. There's a lot of uncertainty right now, right? There's global health. There's the Transformation Committee in Division I. There's a CBA in Major League Baseball, right? We don't know, spring training's already delayed, but I'll tell you what, we're gonna play baseball at Niagara this year, right, fellas?
Yeah.
We're gonna play baseball at Niagara. And in a time we're all looking for good news, to me, that's good news. So welcome, we're glad you're here. I know you're gonna have a wonderful evening. I do need to express regrets from our president, Father Marr. He usually attends this event, and enjoys a huge baseball fan, Mets fan, if there's any Mets fans in the crowd. I'm a Pirates fan, so there may not be a baseball season ever again for the Pirates, at least a Major League season. But Father Marr does express his regrets. He would love to be here with us tonight, but he is a fantastic leader on our campus in higher education, and also just always in our corner in the athletics department, so we appreciate him. But that's all I wanted to say. Thank you. Good luck this year, guys. We'll be pulling for you. Look forward to watching you, and enjoy the evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Simon. Of course, thank you for your leadership. So in 2013, when we closed school for 2 days in a row and I sent the email out, and you guys have all heard the story, the hashtag Thomas Burns, which is my name, I didn't introduce myself before, went to number 2 in the world on Twitter. Like it was, the students were tweeting things like, hashtag Thomas Burns cooks his minute rice in 58 seconds. Hashtag Thomas Burns rode an inner tube over the Niagara Falls and called it the Lazy River. And there was almost 2,000 tweets in about 40 minutes. And there was nothing else going on that night. There was no bombings, no Oscars, nothing else that would create a hashtag that would be much more popular than me. But, you know, a lot of times there's a big news night, somebody said, you know, whatever. But it was a quiet night. So then, over the coming years, then people would, they found on my Twitter handle, which is at tburns262, and they would just tweet at me, say, hey, it's supposed to snow, hashtag Thomas Burns, tburns, what do you think? That doesn't happen. And you know what they do? They just email me directly now. I've gotten 30 emails this week. What do you think? Supposed to snow. I'm like, all right, Ariana, I'm going to close the school because you think it's going to snow. I'm sorry if Ariana's here tonight. They were praying for snow. We're going to pray before our dinner tonight. It's my pleasure to introduce the Reverend Joseph Hubbard for our invocation this evening. He has shoes on. He's not shoeless Joe Hubbard. He's just Joe Hubbard.
As I was sat at my table, I was asked how long this is. I said, it's big print. 12 font. I was told that's not big. I said, it's all caps, so it should be all right. And we pray. Loving God, be with us gathered here this evening as we have come together in friendship and fellowship. As we gather, student athletes, coaches and staff, family and friends, and beginning the 2022 season for Niagara University's baseball team, it happens that we do so as a torch has been lit above Winter Olympic athletes from all over the world. In the spirit of the Olympics, our event tonight is also about wishes and support for our team as they seek to use the talents which are your gifts to them as individuals and as a team to be faster, to be able to reach higher goals, and to be stronger always together. Continue to bless them all in the season that unfolds so that they might experience joy in the sport they love as they realize many achievements, but also in knowledge and wisdom, even as they might deal with challenges. May they experience many hopes fulfilled in their going forth on this journey, doing so with the aim in baseball of always coming home safe. We thank you for the interest and support provided by our NU baseball families and friends, as well as the faithful friends and alumni of Niagara University for this team and all of its endeavors. Our hearts filled with joy on such an evening, Lord, we do pray that you help all of us to grow in your love so as to provide to others the care that you give to us. Guide us to work with you in making a difference in our world, so as to offer a welcome to the many who face the fear of not knowing if they might ever be at home again. With grateful hearts for the meal we are about to share, we ask your blessing, dear Lord, on this, the fruit of your bounty, as we ask for your blessing on those who have prepared our food and for those who serve us tonight. Guide us to work with you to build up your kingdom of justice and peace. In your name, God, source of all that is good, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And the pasta's still warm.
Thank you, Father Joe. One other welcome. Simon mentioned Father Marr, who couldn't be with us tonight. There is a member from the senior leadership team, Reverend Aidan Rooney, CM, the Vice President for Mission Integration. Thanks for being with us tonight, Father. So we're going to get started on our dinner here. The tables will be called. They'll go table to table and call you. I know somebody wanted table 8 to be called first, but I have no say in that. I'm sorry. I got nothing. So I'm asking for 11 to go first, but we're not going to do that either. So they'll call your table. Once again, please put on your mask before you go up to get your food. Sit back down. Enjoy your evening. We'll be back with the program in just a little bit.
Having the opportunity to play baseball at Niagara, it's honestly changed the entire trajectory of my life. The lessons I've learned here, they've not only made me a better baseball player, but I think it's set me up to excel at whatever I end up doing in life. The best advice I could give to the younger guys, pretty much just never compare yourself to others. Instead, just focus on being the best form of yourself that you can be. If you work every day to just be better than you were yesterday, I don't think you'll ever be disappointed. And honestly, I just think that's the key to being able to look back on your life and have no regrets.
My time here at NU has been one of the most special times of my life thus far. Coach McCoy and Spatty gave me the opportunity to play here, and I truly think it was one of the best decisions I have ever made. The culture surrounding the program has allowed me to become not only a better player, but also a better person. The coaching staff does an incredible job at setting us up to have a successful future post-baseball, and I am incredibly grateful for that. My advice for the younger guys would be to not take your time here for granted. Coming from someone who has been here for 5 years, your time passes in the blink of an eye. So enjoy your time and cherish all the memories you make with the guys.
My best advice to the younger guys would be don't leave anything on the table and work hard every day to make this the best program it can be. Also, continue making genuine connections with your teammates because they will be your brothers for life. Also, what it meant to me to play at Niagara, it meant everything. Being able to compete at a high level with my teammates and coaches who are family. The lifelong bonds and friendships that we created along the way and all the knowledge I learned from my coaches. These are things I will remember and cherish for the rest of my life, and I am truly grateful. Thank you, Niagara.
Here. Playing at Niagara has meant everything to me. These are the years that we do the most growing up as players and as men. I'm very fortunate that I've been surrounded by incredible players and coaches that have pushed myself to be the best version of me each day. The friendships and lessons I will take away from here will stick with me for the rest of my life. What to leave the younger guys? Your time here goes by in the blink of an eye, so don't waste a moment. As coaches told us before, don't count your days here, make your days count.
To play here at Niagara University, my time here is something I'll never forget. The practices, lift games, and the time spent off the field with the guys who'd be friends for the rest of my life. Given the opportunity to play here for Coach McCoy and Coach Spatty is a blessing, and I'll never forget my time and memories here. The advice I give to younger guys is keep your head down and work. You'll never know what opportunity lies next for you if you just keep working and go all out and have fun.
Getting the opportunity to play here at Niagara has meant the world to me. I got to meet my best friends for life from all over the world and travel around the country and play the sport I love. It was my home away from home for the past 4 years, and it's something I will never trade. I have learned life lessons that will help me excel in life after college, even off the diamond. The best advice to the underclassmen would be to never take anything for granted. Take the time, hang out with the team, and get to know each other. That's your family for the next 4 years. Make the most of your time here because time flies when you're having fun and soon you'll be as a senior.
For me, being part of Niagara baseball has meant being part of a family. We all have our strengths and flaws, but in the end, we support each other no matter what. The relationships I've established and memories I've made with my teammates in my time here will last a lifetime. From a personal standpoint, I can tell the younger guys to never take 1 second for granted. Things that you never expected can happen. I can't believe how fast the time goes. Cherish every moment and every day you get to be a part of this team. Spend every opportunity to be the best version of yourself.
Being a part of Niagara baseball for the past 5 years has been a great blessing in my life. Not only is it based on the relationships and teamwork that has come of it, but the person it has made me today based on the experiences I've had with my teammates, the long bus rides, and it's you don't remember on the field as much as you do off the field. As far as advice for the younger guys, I would just like to say it's over in a flash. You never know when your number's up. Don't let anyone take the jersey off your back. Just keep your nose to the grindstone. It's amazing what you can accomplish in your time here if you just take a little bit and do a lot. It's amazing to me how far some of the players that I've played with have come from where they've started to where they've finished.
Me to play at Niagara has been absolutely everything. I mean, the experiences I've gained, the people I've met, the lessons I've learned. It certainly has changed who I am as a person, the man I've become, and honestly has shaped a large part of where I am today and where I will be down the road. Grant, big thanks to Rob McCoy for giving me an opportunity and Matt Spatafora, and honestly, my teammates. I mean, you guys have meant the world to me. Genuinely mean it when I say that you guys are all my brothers. That's got to be the biggest thing for me is being away from home so long. I genuinely, genuinely love every single one of you guys in the room. I can say that confidently. I'll be there for every single one of you whenever you need it. 5 years down the road, 2 weeks down the road, in June when, you know, we're going to be in a conference championship, that you guys mean everything to me. This program means everything to me, and being able to play here has been nothing but a dream. Advice for the younger guys. For me, you know, one of the things my grandfather always told me was the best time to plant a tree was 10 years ago. And as I grow up and I learn, don't regret anything, whether it be how hard you work on the field, off the field, the homework that you should do, the extra work you could put into what you're doing, and, you know, the experiences you can have with friends and teammates. 10 years down the road, you want to look back at your time here and absolutely say that you got the absolute most out of your time here in Niagara. For me, guys, that would be the biggest thing. It goes by really quick, whether you have 3 years left, 4 years left, whatever the case may be.
Niagara University means a lot to me. You know, coming in as a 17-year-old kid, you know, you think you know a lot, but during my 4.5 years here, I've definitely not just grown as a baseball player, but as a young man. And that's just a testament to the values that Coach McCoy and Coach Spadafora have kind of built into us, and that's kind of the cores of our program that we have, is that there's not just things that can benefit us on the baseball field, even though it does, like, tremendously. I've benefited from, you know, the values and the core values that we have in our program that you can kind of see just based upon how the guys on our team just go about themselves. You know, coming as a 17-year-old kid, you think you know a lot, but during the time that I've been here, it's definitely helped me progress as not just a baseball player, as a young man. And that's something that has given me opportunities past college and in the future that I appreciate out of this university so much. And then some advice I would give to the younger guys would just be embrace it. Embrace the fall. You know, we have just a long fall. We just play inter-squad, just practice. And, you know, you get in a lull. And that's one thing that why we appreciate our season so much. We start in February and we hope to end in June. But, you know, it's not a long time. It's really not. Even though I feel like I've been here a while, but I wouldn't rather be anywhere else. Like, this is embrace the fall, embrace just the guys around you. You know, the opportunities that we get are great. We get the opportunity to meet guys from all over. We have 45 guys on our team, and they're from all over the country, all over Canada. Like, it's something that I wouldn't have been able to do if I wasn't here, and I appreciate that so much.
Having the opportunity to take the field alongside my brothers as a Purple Eagle and playing for Coach McCoy and Coach Spat has by far been one of my greatest experiences of my playing career. From the multiple opportunities to the support I have received on and off the field has proved why Niagara Baseball is more than just a team, but a family. My advice to our younger players is to go out of your comfort zone and don't be afraid to fail. Your teammates and coaches will be there to pick you up and push you ahead more than ever.
Not everyone gets the opportunity to continue playing their sport in college, but I'm thankful every day that I got to. It has shaped me to become a person I want to be. I have become a hard worker, a leader, someone who doesn't give up, and someone who knows how to support others. The support is the greatest part of being on a team. Your teammates support you through your sport in the classroom and in your personal life. Some advice I have is every second you spend comparing your life to someone else's is a second spent wasting yours. Stop comparing and create your own definition of success instead.
Being a Purple Eagle has meant the world to me. Coming to play for Coach McCoy and Coach Spadafora has helped shape me into being the best person and player I could be, and being so far from home. Buffalo, Niagara Falls, and specifically this community have really become my home away from home. And I just can't thank the people and players I've played with enough for making it that special. My advice to the younger guys is to make the best of every situation you're in. Always, always be yourself and hold your head high through the good and the bad.
My time here at Niagara, as it slowly comes to an end, has been a journey. I've met people, met friends, and my teammates. My teammates are not teammates to me anymore. They're brothers, more like family than anything. They'll do anything for you, and I'll do anything for them. As one thing I like to say to the younger freshmen and sophomores is, make the most of your time here. Meet people, talk to people, be yourself. Don't try to change yourself for anyone else. and have the most fun and experience what you want to experience at home here. Thank you.
What my time at Niagara has meant to me is something indescribable. Coach McCoy, Spatty, and the school gave me the opportunity to play my dream sport while getting my education as well. This team and school have been a huge part of my life, and I can't wait to see what we will do this season. Let's ride, baby. And to younger guys, the best advice I can give you is to trust in your ability. You're here for a reason. Stay loose and have as much fun as possible. These 4 years go by quick. Well, five if you take the route I did. Love you, boys. That's Big BSF, baby.
And for me, Niagara University has meant everything to me. I've made friendships and memories both on and off the field that I'll cherish for the rest of my life. And some advice that I'd give to the younger guys, Coach McCoy recruited us for who you are and who you are as a player. So just be that player, be that person, just be yourself.
The culture surrounding the program has allowed me to become not only a better player, but also a better person, and I am incredibly grateful for that.
Playing at Niagara has meant everything to me. I'm very fortunate that I've been surrounded by incredible players and coaches.
It's definitely helped me progress as not just a baseball player, as a young man. And that's something that has given me opportunities past college and in the future that I appreciate out of this university so much.
Oh, baby, what a play by swing and a miss. They got a good look at the strike out there. Chaos pitch. Called strike three.
This one driven into deep left field, going back, and it's gone.
Breaking ball, ripped out to left. Back goes Victory at the track. He jumped, it's off his glove, and it's a home run! Front average, next pitch swung on, hit high in the air. Deep to right, way back, gone! Back goes Bailey, he's at the track, he's at the wall, he leaps, and he makes the catch! Farrell puts the tag on, and an ending double play.
Going back. Oh my goodness, did he catch that? He did.
Missing around the bag at third. He's getting the wave. Here comes the throw. Not in time.
That the winning, of the making the playoff, winning the conference and all that stuff, that's going to happen. That's an ancillary benefit of having the best program that we could ever have and the pride that we have in that place.
Talk about some of that stuff. I just want to thank Mike Jeswald for who does events at Niagara for helping put this thing together. Brianna in Sports Info, thank you. And parents Cindy O'Connor, Todd and Diana O'Brien, and Paul and Pam Giordano for showing up and helping put the raffle and the baskets together and all that stuff. That was very helpful. Thank you very much. And then to all the parents that either brought a basket or brought an auction item or anything, it's so incredible to have the support that we have from our parent group. It's just great. And it just underscores how much I love this program. And, you know, Spat and I work really hard to get the right guys in the room. And we've got the right guys, I can tell you that right now. And it shows because of the parent support, the way they were raised, all of that. You guys should be very happy with them as young men, because they're, you know, I hear a lot of, like, you know, we've taught them things, or, you know, we gave them a chance. First of all, they had the base, so we're just sharing knowledge, number one. And secondly, we didn't give anybody anything. That you guys earned the right to be here. You earned the opportunity to be here, you know, because you're the 40 that are in the room, and whether that be that's not simply talent based. It's attitude. It's hard to have a family if you guys aren't family oriented. So all of that stuff, you know, wrapped in a bow is why this room is, we're able to have this the way we are and come together like this and have so much support to an event like this. And, you know, the byproduct of this event is a fundraiser, but the reality of it is it's to get people who care about this program in the same room and celebrate what a great program we have. And you know, because for years we didn't have one of these, and I felt, you know, every time we would do an event or every time we would go somewhere, do community service or be around people at the school, we always got, you know, everyone would say such great things, and I thought, let's get all those people in a room and let's celebrate how cool these guys are and how they go about their business and how special this team is, because they are, and that's why we started it, and that's why we've kept it going, and it wouldn't be possible without everybody in this room, you know, doing their part. So I thank you guys for that. So to kick this off, before I get started, so a couple years ago, I was approached by a guy by the name of Pat Scroy, and his brother is an alum, and he tragically passed away at a young age due to cancer, and it was kind of a tragic story. And, you know, I was aware of the story. He was a high school baseball coach at St. Francis High School, you know, so I knew him from the recruiting aspect of things. And he approached me and said, you know, we do these things at the high school, we do these things at schools that he's been involved with, organizations that he's been involved with. How can we do something at Niagara that's lasting, that has a lasting effect? And I said, well, and he wanted to basically, you know, do we do a memorial? Do we do do we put some plants out at the field? Whatever it may be. And I said, well, why don't we invest that into the quality of the first pitch dinner, and then every year put his name on the dinner, so that we can honor him every year, and new classes of kids that play here will kind of understand what he's about. So we have a special treat today, because we actually have his college coach in the room to say a few words about him. Last year I read a statement, but this year we're lucky enough to have Jim Morrow, who's the athletic director at Canisius High School. His son, Vinny, is a freshman on our team. So Jim, would you like to come up and say a few words?
Thank you. Thanks, I appreciate it. First off, just to echo what Rob said, this is an amazing show of support for Niagara baseball. When I coached, our fundraising was basically our team taking tickets at the basketball game. We made like 10 bucks a kid. So this is a little bit better fundraiser. Good job. Jeff Scroy, first, to echo again what Rob said, Pat Scroy and his wife have been so supportive in our community with youth sports, and obviously here with this dinner. They deserve a tremendous amount of thanks. as somebody who's in the high school ranks, they get involved with everything they possibly can to make it a better experience for the young men playing sports in Western New York. So I'd like to thank Pat and his wife and his family for their support of Niagara baseball. Jeff Scroy. Jeff was a do-over. Coaches don't do everything right. Jeff, I always categorize as a do-over guy. I saw Jeff play as West Seneca. Saw him play when he was maybe 16, 15. He was an outfielder. You could see when you watched him, his determination, even at that age, his focus, his love of the game. Back then, didn't have a lot of scholarship money. It wasn't a position that I was recruiting at. We tried to get him to come to Niagara, he visited, he liked it, but unfortunately went to Lemoyne, and he spent a couple years there. He called me after 2 years and he said, "Coach, I want to come back and play for you in Niagara." If I had to do it all over again, I would have had him come from the get-go. I would have found more money somewhere. Jeff was diligent. He was dedicated. He was so, so passionate about this sport. He was businesslike in how he did things. Outfielder, very steady. Left-hand hitter, could absolutely rake. He could hit. And all he did each and every day was get ready and play his heart out. Jeff ended up, as Coach said, going and helping out at St. Francis High School. When he passed away, St. Francis had a beautiful memorial mass for him in their auditorium, and myself and some of the people from my high school went to the mass. And it was funny because Pat had a video. Jeff, in our first game back to Lemoyne, the school he left, came up in the Sax Juice situation late in the ball game and hit a rocket. And if you've ever been to Lemoyne, it almost hit the houses across the street. And this video brought back so many memories of Jeff. And when he came around third base and I went to give him a high five, it just about broke my hand. And as I was watching that video, I could almost feel it in my hand again. He was a wonderful human being. He spent a lot of time with the kids at St. Francis. He dedicated himself to the game. So having this in his memory is a special thing. And I can tell you, after coming out to a few fall games here for you guys all wearing the Niagara jerseys, that there's a lot of talent in this room. There's a lot of talent. And if each one of you come out each and every day with the same type of dedication, focus, commitment, work ethic, you have a significant chance to make history. You can make history. You can be the first Niagara University baseball team to go to the NCAAs. I kid you not. Jeff was gone too early, he left here too early. But I can tell you this, he would love to come out and watch you guys play. And again, you should think of him every so often as somebody who left too early, but just absolutely loved the game and loved Niagara, most importantly. Thanks for having me.
Notes. Okay. Thank you, Jim. That was outstanding, and definitely thank the Scroy family for helping this event happen. So before we get on to it, let's talk about when Dawson's baby pictures popped up. I saw Darian, who's an alum. He was chirping him a little bit, that table. And then Darian, your face changed a little bit when you saw that home run against Sienna, didn't it? I saw that. Dawson's the target.
always. We've played a lot of ball since. There's been a lot of cool things, and I'm not going to take up too much time because we have a great speaker tonight. But some highlights. So the last one of these dinners we had was in spring of 2020. We were 3 months unknowingly away from a global pandemic and sitting at home in quarantine for months at a time. But we had a great start to that season. It was unbelievable. Friday night against number 14 Florida State, we went toe to toe with them and ended up beating them. It was one of the most epic wins of my entire life, and I think these guys would agree. We did some. You know, we had three more road trips after that and got some good wins. We got to go out west. We got to experience a lot of things that I think a lot of guys enjoyed. And that year will always be special, even though it got cut short. We weren't able to do this last year, but last year was the year of the COVID restrictions. I know not all of you were a part of this group last year, but the ones that were, I just want you guys to know, as parents, what your sons, like, what they endured and they crushed around every corner, how they dealt with the things that they had to deal with, we had a lot of things we had to do. We were told we had to do this. You have to do this. You have to do this. And there was very little pushback, and it all kept going back to the same thing. If we want this to work and we want this to be a special season, we have to do this. We have to just say, this is what we need to do. And the selflessness and sacrifice of these guys to deal with that last year and how we ended up doing, which was better, still not where we want to be, but we turned a corner that Jim, I think you're absolutely right. This team has a chance to do something incredibly special. So it's a matter of getting out there and letting our talent play. And then this year, we're just really excited to have a normal season so far. I'm going to talk about the grades. I want to show you a trend. Spring of 2020, 3.64 as a team. Fall of 2020, 3.57 as a team. That's 35 plus guys getting a cumulative GPA of that. Fall of 21, 3.37, the spring of 21 at 3.37, and the fall of 21 at 3.25. That shows two things. Number one, this group is incredibly dedicated to the classroom. They take what we teach and apply it to all areas of their life, not just the field. But it also shows that this last fall they had to learn how to go to school again. We dropped down a little bit because they had to go in-person classes again finally. Since we've hey, it's true, you guys know it. Since we last saw each other, we've had a kid get called up to the big leagues, Matt Brash, the first time in I think 30 or 40 years, maybe longer. We have three guys currently in AAA, Greg Cullen, Tanner Kerwer, and Winton Bernard. And Winton's been in pro ball since he was drafted in 2012. And then one in AA last year, Daniel Procopio. So the guys that we have sent on are having significant amount of success. We're really looking forward to having a normal spring. A lot of the time we've spent this fall and spring is on leadership and communication. And so I always like to talk about what these guys are working on and what we're doing to try to turn the corner. We have our core values. They live our core values very well. As many guys as we have that are older, we have almost that many younger guys too. And so it's been an evolving process to get the team to mesh and up to speed, and these guys to communicate and show leadership, and they're handling it extremely well. And so we've had a productive fall. We're going into the spring. We've had challenges. The Kiernan Center is getting worked on. Spatty and I haven't had an office except for the press box all year, and we're making do. But we face challenges. But every day these guys show up to work, they show up to play, they show up to do what is required of them to be Niagara baseball players. And I'm just so very proud of them. Okay, so why don't we give the players a round of applause for everything? want to thank everybody in here again. I'll wrap this up, and I'll let Bill take over, and this is going to be a great presentation. So thank you, everybody.
Thanks, Coach. Thanks for your words. Of course, your leadership and bringing us all here tonight. So before coming to Niagara University, I worked a couple jobs ago at the Buffalo Bisons. I worked there for about 10 years as Director of Public Relations and Marketing. And I met a number of people over the course of my time there, worked closely with teams and that, and I keep in touch with about four or five former players, not because of how they played or whatever, but because of who they are. One is David Roberts, who's the manager of the Los Angeles Dodgers, incredible human being. Greg LaRocca, who played here, played in the big leagues a little for the Indians and the Padres, I think, and played in Japan. Jeff Manto, who played for the Orioles and a number of teams in the big leagues. Mark Budzinski, who's currently the first base coach of the Toronto Blue Jays. And our speaker tonight, Bill Selby. In 1998, I got a call from the PR director at the Pawtucket Red Sox, the Boston's AAA team. And we were talking about the start of the season, who's on each person's team, and you trade headshots before the internet, really, so you have to mail somebody a headshot of somebody if you had it. And he says, yeah, you guys got Bill Selby this year. I go, yeah, I didn't know Bill really at all. He says, he hits the ball hard, is what he said. I said, okay, AAA, they should hit the ball hard, but he noticed that. And then Bill got here. And in 1999, I think we had Sandy Alomar. Now, I say this knowing that I'm an old person. You guys know who Sandy Alomar is? Yes. Yeah, you never know. So Sandy was on injury rehab, and he's sitting in the dugout, and I come through the dugout, going out to the field. He goes, hey, that's what he goes, what place are we in? I'm thinking, Sandy, you're Cleveland Indians. You're like in first place by about 8 games. What are you talking about? He said, no, here. He points the Bisons on the chest. What place are we in? I said, we're in second place, about 2.5 games back. Okay, we'll be in first place by the time I leave. I said, okay, great. And who's that guy out there, 29? Who's that? I go, that's Bill Selby. He goes, he hits the ball hard. yes, he does. At that point, I knew. And he did hit the ball hard. With the Bisons, he is the modern era leader. We count everything in AAA from 1985 on as modern era. Leader in RBI, hits, runs scored, doubles. He's third in the team in home runs with 60 in the modern era. And as great as he was as a player, he's a better person. But I can't let the story go. You guys, who here is a Bills fan? Well, you never know. They might be from somewhere else. I don't know. So you remember a few years ago when the Bills beat Miami, then they went in the locker room and they were watching the Bengals play to see if they could get in the playoffs and if the Bengals could score. I had a moment like that in a clubhouse. We were playing Syracuse, the Blue Jays affiliate at the time. I was still at Cleveland. The Bisons were still at Cleveland. And we beat Syracuse 5-4, and the guys all get into the clubhouse, and they quick turn on the TV. And because they all watch baseball. You watch baseball, right? You get in, watch baseball, you play video games, you go play baseball. Not that it's a one-dimensional life, but So they turn on the game, and the Indians are playing the Yankees, so we get the Yankees network here. And the Yankees had won. Do we have Yankees fans in the crowd? Yeah. Father, keep them in your prayers, would you, that they find the error of their ways. But anyway, so the Yankees were winning 7-0 in that game, and the Indians had clawed back, and it's the bottom of the ninth inning, the bases are loaded, and Bill Selby is up at bat. And he's facing Mariano Rivera. You know who Mariano Rivera is? Mariano Rivera gave up 71 home runs in his life over 19 seasons. That's less than 4 a year. He gave one up to Bill Selby, a grand slam home run. And Jim Mora, if you think that you got your hand slapped pretty hard on that, I don't know if I've ever seen a home run trot faster than watching this highlight. If you get a chance to watch the home run trot from Bill Selby in that game, go back and do it. It's on YouTube, you'll find it. He is a full out sprint. I don't think your feet touch the ground, Bill, in that. Bill is a, when I was at the Bisons, the other thing too, we did our program books, and I wanted to bring this out. There was a guy by the name of Grant Nolan who lived in East Aurora, and he drew DC Comics for Batman, for the DC Comics, so we had him do our covers. So he did us a Bill Selby cover as a superhero. You can't have it, it's mine, it's autographed. We're not raffling it off, I'm keeping it. The other thing I have from Bill Selby, guys, the young guys, you put this on the video, I don't know if you know this is true or not, but metal shrinks over time, because I have this ring that Bill helped us win in 1998. It doesn't fit. It shrunk over the years, but I still have the ring from the 1998 championship. It is my pleasure to introduce the 1999 Bison's MVP, a member of the Greater Buffalo Baseball Sports Hall of Fame, and my dear friend, Mr. Bill Selby.
Forgive me, I gotta wear glasses. Getting a little old. I'll you a little later after that. It's flattering. Eli, my son that's here, will tell you I don't like to speak a lot about myself or my accomplishments or anything that I'm fortunate to accomplish. I get a little shy talking about myself, so I'm always can smile when somebody else does it though, so it's pretty cool. Tonight, you know, I got to go back to the video, you guys. Is that a hype video? We call it a hype video. That it was pretty cool. Who hit the home run? The last home run. Where are you going? That was nice. That was nice. Nobody announced was I'm a collegiate coach as well. I've been coaching in a junior college at Northwest Mississippi Community College for the last 16 years, and so we start next Friday, our first game. And that just gave me everything I needed to be ready to go. That was awesome. So, you know, I think you guys have a lot of those memories that you guys are about to make. Thank you, Coach McCoy. Thanks, Coach Spatty, University Program, for having me tonight. It's an honor. I think you guys would probably think, especially with my accent, that I'm telling a story when I tell you that I'm excited to be back here in 18-degree weather. But I am. Buffalo's dear to us. Even though Eli and I had quite the trip getting here, we flew in from New Orleans Thursday, and we had our flight canceled, what, 3 or 4 times? So the closest we could get was Newark. And so it took a couple of Mississippi fellas about 9 hours to make a 6-hour trip over here, because we're scared of the snow where I'm from. And so, you know, ironically, civilization goes on here when we snow. We got a lot of snow here. Everything keeps going. We had the threat of snow Thursday, and it shut school down. There was enough food on the shelves in the grocery store. Everything's done, so it's always nice to come back. I don't mind the weather. I enjoy the cold. It's a beautiful place. It's got a special place in our heart. You know, this is a unique opportunity for me tonight, and I say that because I've never had the opportunity to speak to a university. It's always been high school first pitch banquets. It's always been end of the year banquets. It's always been coaches clinics, something, or a lot of one-on-one time or round tables or whatever. So this is the first. And so I'll kind of follow in the adage and the advice that a couple of my players gave me in return, what I'm always giving them before I came up here. And they said, where are you going? You going to Eli's school? And I'm like, yeah, what are you doing? I'm gonna go speak. They said, all right, coach, just try not to mess it up. Just don't mess it up. Whatever it is. I appreciate it. So I'm going to try not to mess this up. You know, I wear a few different hats tonight, and it's kind of unique for me because, well, I'm a speaker, that's one. But also, I am a collegiate coach. I get to share the same excitement, the same hopes, and the same anxiety for this time of the year. You guys are ready to kick it off, what, in 2 weeks? And we got it Friday. So I have the same butterflies you guys have. I think even at 51 years old, I still have the same emotions you guys are running through your body right now. So I share that. But also, can we have a show of parents? Raise your hands if your parents are here of a student athlete. All right, guys, I'm going to ask you to clap your hands. Okay? All right. I get to share that as well. I'm a proud father. And if you don't know my son yet, Eli, he's the guy that shares the same accent. And we use the pronoun y'all quite frequently. And if you guys don't know what y'all means, it's everybody but me. So, but I'm proud of Eli being here. I make a joke about this. I don't think Eli had any intentions of this happening, but, you know, Eli, I tell everybody he tried to get as far away north as he could from me when he signed here and committed to come here. And he always told me, you know, I'm just trying to get out from under your thumb. I just want to get out from under your thumb. And so the day he signed, I sent him a link to a newspaper article that is in the Herd Chronicles the next day about Bill Selby's son signs with Niagara. You're not getting away from it, buddy. I'm sorry. Anyway, so, but I get to wear the same hats as you parents, too. So I'm excited to be a part of the program. I'm new to it. I went through the same things as the recruiting process. Even though I'm a coach and I do the recruiting, it was unique to do it. So I have the same, and I'm looking forward to the next several years of being here. Being here as much as I can, as much as my schedule allows. Maybe I'll see you again whenever I get a chance. So, you know, again, being a collegiate atmosphere and getting to speak to the university, there were a lot of things that went through my mind. What should I talk about? You know, what should I speak about? I don't like to talk about myself. I don't like to do those things. But Eli will confirm that this is the age group that I most closely relate to. I get to spend a lot of time. I'm coaching guys in college. So I enjoy that age group the most. So, but I've never talked to them other than coaching. So I picked Coach McCoy's brain a couple weeks ago. We got to talk about travel plans here. And I don't think he wanted to talk to me as long as I did. So I asked him a few questions about his program, what he feels about this season, some of the things he was looking forward to. Guys, it was all positive. It was exactly what he was telling you right here. Accountability came up. He's excited about the leadership. Excited about, you know, a lot of what was said by you seniors, the word brotherhood, family came up a lot. He's excited about the family you guys have, the bond that you've built. So that got me thinking, you know what? I think this is what I'd like to do. And ladies and gentlemen, you're going to have to forgive me because tonight I'm just going to speak directly to the team. And this is their time. This is what this is about. This is what you guys are supporting. And without these guys, we don't have a program. So I'm going to speak directly, not as a player, but more so as a coach about, you know, this opportunity that we have tonight. You know, when I played, I like to walk around a little bit. So if I start walking around, y'all forgive me. I can't sit still. So when I played with the theory of and the philosophy of the best me would make a better us. Correct? We all agree that's the way it is. That's logical. And so anything I say tonight is not going to be mind-blowing. It's not going to be anything you've never heard or anything that I can write a book about, but it's just how my experiences as a player that I've came up with the philosophy I try to teach our guys at Northwest. And so when I said Northwest Mississippi Community College, if I didn't mention that, that's why I coach. Look it up. We actually hosted Cole Tucker about 3 years ago. He got a taste of our big left-hander that is with Memphis right now. But So Cole's been to Northwest. But anyway, so when I refer to Northwest, that's who I'm referring to. But over time, as a player, getting it wrong, getting it right, and then as a coach more so throughout observing our players, I'm trying to help our guys understand the value of creating value for yourself and being selfish so we can impact our team positively. And so what I'm asking my team to do is understand that what we play, and this is what I teach, and this seems illogical, and you're going to say, you got this backwards, Coach. We play an individual sport at a team level. Well, Coach, it's a team sport. Well, in theory, it's a team sport. But we essentially play an individual sport at a team level. All right, hockey, what else we got? Soccer, lacrosse, basketball. Those are all individual sports. Well, Coach, you got it wrong. It's a team sport. No, it's individual because it's a collection of individuals. And there are vast arrays of talents and skills and how that applies and how that impacts the team. So what I'm teaching my guys is a level of selfishness that is hard to teach at a collegiate level when team trumps any individual. Do we agree? Especially at this level, Division I level, nobody wants to talk about being selfish. Of course, in professional sports, it's all about being selfish. But there's a level of selfishness I'm teaching my guys so they understand that selfishness they're learning makes for a positive impact on our program. All right, so that's what I'm going to give you guys tonight. So what kind of selfishness am I teaching, Coach? Well, we call it conditional selfishness. And that means I'm going to focus on the things I need to do today with all the dedication, all the focus I've got so I can create value for myself, which in turn positively impacts my team. Okay, it's pretty simple, right? It's not hard to understand, and you guys, Coach, I understand that. The best me makes a better us. Yes, of course. But there's a level of selfishness you have to understand that I got to focus on me in the present moment. All right. I'll give you an example. All right. So, Jake, where are you, Jake? Okay. I was told to call you Buzzy because you don't go by Jake. All right. I Okay, so buzzing. I just want to make sure I got that right. So I didn't know if that was because that ball buzzed by your shoulder. That scared everybody for a minute. All right, so buzzing. I was fortunate enough to get to go watch practice yesterday. Stood there and watched, observed. There were gentlemen, had plenty of guys come up, introduce themselves. I enjoy watching baseball, evaluating, just getting to be a part of the program and watching you guys go about your business. But yesterday was live batting practice. We agree, live batting practice is never fun. We're in the Kiernan Center, can't see. There's no backdrop, I get it. That's, you kind of got a little JUCO grind going right there. So, but as Buzzy's getting ready to throw, but Buzzy's kind of an optimal nickname because there was a lot of energy. I felt the energy, you know what I mean? Guys are talking smack, hitters are getting talking back and forth. I got my little game face on, guys are trying to have ABs and trying to show them up. The energy level's brought up. So I assume when Buzzy goes, the team goes, am I right? Am I right? Buzzy goes, so the best Jake is gonna make us a better Niagara, correct? All right, so it's imperative that Jake takes everything he has each day to improve himself individually. Why? Well, that's selfish. Yes, it is selfish. That's what I'm trying to teach. If he takes care of himself in pre-prep, post-prep, nutrition, weight room, classroom, all these things to create value for himself, then obviously it's going to impact us positively, right? We always talk team. We always talk team. And I never want to take team out of your mouth. But understand that when you focus on yourself in that moment, you are creating value for yourself, which in turn makes Niagara University a better team. Do we agree? All right, so that's what I'm teaching. So I'll give you a big league example. I'm not going to stand up here and talk about myself. I saw there was a few Yankees fans in here, right? All right, well, I was a Yankees fan too. I grew up back in the Stone Age when we wore wood cleats and all that stuff. And so all we could watch on TV was the Yankees, even back in Mississippi. So I grew up a Yankees fan. The night I got drafted, or the night before I got drafted, the Yankees called me. I was a senior sign out of Southern Miss. Guy called me, hey, how would you like to hit those home runs in Yankee Stadium? I thought it was the best thing that ever happened to me. I thought, oh my gosh, a dream come true. The next day, I got drafted by the Red Sox. And let me tell you, it's real, the disdain you have for the Yankees immediately. Because I thought, oh, the Yankees, ugh. You know, so for you Red Sox fans, Stilly, where else? Who else is a Red Sox fan, right? Brady, okay, we got a few, good. All right, Sox Nation. All right, so you guys are fans of Manny Ramirez, correct? Everybody knows Manny? We know Manny? Okay. He's the answer to the question I get all the time. Who's the best hitter you ever played with? Before the question is finished, I interrupt and say, Manny Ramirez. Best hitter I've ever seen in my eyes. Next to Barry Bonds, I never played with Barry Bonds, just saw him and he was pretty awesome. But Manny Ramirez was hands down the best hitter I ever saw. We all know Manny for Manny being Manny, right? That's the old terminology. We see the Manny who hits, Dawson, is that your name? Is that Dawson?
Yep.
We see Manny hitting home runs like Dawson hit right there, standing there, big baggy uniform, flipping his bat there. That's great, right? That's Manny. But what people don't understand, I was fortunate enough to play with him in Cleveland, right? For the few years I was with Cleveland. And Manny had a routine about creating some value for himself. This is what people don't see about Manny. Manny was, you see the Manny that we all see on SportsCenter, and I got to see him firsthand with his three hits every night, and his three RBIs, and his baseball card stats. I mean, it's crazy. But Manny, I was kind of a gym rat. My wife was going through nursing school when I first got to the big leagues, so I didn't get to see her a lot. So I spent a lot of time at the field. I figured I'm spending this much money on clubhouse dues, I'm gonna make the most of it, eat lunch there, and spend as much time as I could there, right? So every day in a homestand at Cleveland, Manny would show up when it's time to lift. He'd get there about 10, 11 o'clock. Whenever the strength coach would meet him, he'd get his lift in, take a shower, he'd leave, go eat lunch. I watched this for a little while. Nobody saw, no cameras around. There's no articles being written. There's no documentaries or anything. Just Manny showed up, left, and came back. So about 1 or 2 o'clock every day on a homestand. Manny'd come back, six clothes back on. He'd go to the third cage in our top tunnels. That was third cage over from the left from our weight room in Jacobs Field. It was Jacobs Field when I played in Cleveland. Whoever was our bat boy for the day, he paid him a fee, and he'd sit up there for 30 to 45 minutes to an hour. And the machine was set on sliders that threw mid-shin, about 3 inches off the outside part of the plate, and never moved. Now, this isn't a hack attack where we got bad balls, and you're having to adjust the dial every pitch. One fastball goes this way. We have the same thing, guys. It's frustrating. This is brand-new, crisp, golf ball-type baseballs. and they're painting an 87 minor slider down the lane. Never changed. Every day he did that, 30, 45 minutes. It never changed. His approach changed. And if you know Manny, he's got that pretty swing, nice high leg kick, and he's just lacing balls in the right field. Just lacing one after the other. It looks like it's on replay. Nothing's changed. It's the same swing over and over and over. There's never a time, what did you call it last night, Cole, where he did the James Brown swing, where you want to feel good? He never did that. Never. It never was like, I'm going to back leg a few. It was consistently other way. So finally got enough nerve, and Manny was a great teammate. Didn't talk much. Was a little nervous about his dialect, but I said, Manny, you got to tell me why you do this every day. I'm glad you asked, Billy. He used to call me Billy. I'm glad you asked, Billy. Here's why. Because this is the pitch I see over and over and over from pitchers when guys are in scoring position, nine games on the line. If I can hit this pitch, I'm going to win more times than not. Okay, that's a cool. He recognized there was something he needed to develop, had a plan for it, and stuck with it. I was impressed. But he didn't do it because he wanted somebody to see it. He did it on his own time, in his own way. All right. But that didn't end there. What was cool about Cleveland, for us role players that didn't get to play all the time, we had extra BP every day at home. Weather permit, every day for an hour, from 3 to 4 that we stretched, it was our time. We called it group 4 because we were the role players. And we go out there, and it's just coaches and us, and we hit to our hands bleed until it was time for regular BP. So that was kind of, hey, here we go. So every day, and we did this on the road. We could be in Anaheim, we could be in Oakland, we could be in Texas, but we had to do it indoors, it's too hot in Texas. But every big league stadium, every day, weather permit, we had early BP. It's the coolest thing about Cleveland. So every day we do that, you know where Manny was? He grabbed the outfield's glove, he went out power shack. Now granted, there's no other players out there. No other players, not at 3 o'clock, not in the middle of summer. There was no cameras out there. There was nobody writing an article on what Manny's doing. Manny's doing it on his own. He's out there, he's running some balls down, he dives for a few, he doinks a few, whatever it is, but he's out there. Finally, I just asked him, Manny, why do you have to come out here and do this? Well, everybody thinks I can't play defense, Billy. So I'm gonna work on it. I'm gonna prove to him I can play defense. That impacted me and everyone else as much as what he did 4 hours later when he was 3 for 4 and had 4 RBIs, was how he got to the point he was. He didn't show up to spring training, his first spring training, to finish problem. There was a plan he put in place, and it was selfish in the sense that I thought about myself, but how much did it add value to himself, which impacted, obviously, Cleveland at the time and then Boston for the rest of his career. Y'all look at me like, Coach Sebi, that's obvious. I mean, Manny Ramirez, how obvious is it? I could go on and on, Roger Clemens, other guys that I've played with that had the same type work ethic. But what I'm trying to get you guys to understand is there was a method to his madness. Is it wasn't just the bag of uniforms and the success. It's how he got to that point. And so the challenging aspect of this as a collegiate coach is helping you guys understand how to be selfish conditionally and understand what roles, what plans you can attack for yourself so we can add value to your program. Because I'm just as excited about your program as you are now. I got a son a part of it. I can't wait till you get started. I got to find some way to keep up with you guys because that's going to drive me nuts. And so how can I teach that to my guys at Northwest? How can I teach that to you? So I'm going to try to give you a few concepts. I won't be long. He told me I had 2 hours. Is that what you said? Okay. So I won't be long, I promise. Just again, I want you to understand, I'm not rewriting the book. This is simple stuff. But if you understand how to take this daily and apply it to yourself daily, I'm going to give you examples of yourselves that just in one day that I noticed, then you'll understand what I'm talking about when you talk about the selfishness I'm talking about. All right, so number one, you have to have goals set. We all set goals, right? But more importantly, you have to have a plan to attack for those goals. And that plan has to be daily, okay? So a lot of times those plans are set off by our coaches' plans. We write the plans for you guys that day. Or they may be some plans for you to have when you're on your own. It may be the plan that the strength coach gives you to get stronger, or you know, rehab gives you to get healthier, whatever that case may be. But somebody's right plans for you are your right plans for yourself. All right, the goals are great. Don't get me wrong. I think it's a good way to evaluate where you are. Take inventory. Maybe sometimes you're unrealistic. Maybe you're over realistic. I don't, you know, that's a great way to evaluate yourselves. You got to get an idea. I don't know if you guys do it here. We ask our guys to have some, share with us some team goals. Keep it personal. Keep it private. Just some individual goals. Those are great. The most important part is what is your plans to get to that reality? Because that's daily. and it requires a few things. All right, so the goals are great. The plan is always the most important part, and the plan doesn't always focus on, and for me, never focuses on the result. Okay, I don't want you to think about the end result. I want you to think about the drill you're doing at that point. I want you to think about what you've been assigned to do or what you have assigned for yourself to do at that point. All right, so what am I talking about? So this includes the weight room. This includes anything you do. And you guys understand this because you're getting more coaching as if you wanted to come to a banquet and get more coaching. All right, so what I mean by that, so I got, again, I thank you for letting me come to practice. That was awesome. And I plan on coming tomorrow if I've got permission. So as I stood around and watched, now listen, I get it. I get, well, I can't see. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to back the hitters up right quick, pitchers, nothing, no offense. I think we got a good pitching staff. But when you're trying to hit live in a cage where the lights aren't good and there's no backdrops, you got an advantage. I'm just telling you. Okay? So I understand. I still think you got a good staff. Got to throw that one out there. But while live BP was going on, there was a lot of other things, moving parts going on too, right? The beauty of Division One that we don't have as much success with in junior college is you can let the older guys run the stuff that's going on, right? In junior college, we can't. We're babysitting a lot, and that's tough. It's difficult. And it's difficult for when you have two guys on a coaching staff, three at the most at times. We have three. We're fortunate. And that requires me to be diligent with 11 players, okay? But y'all got a lot of stuff going on. Before y'all started BP, there's some one-handed drills. There's some other things, and we can talk about the value of one-handed drills. I'll talk about it until I'm blue in the face after this program, if you'd like to. I won't get into that now. But one-handed drills, some breaking ball machine, fastballs. As live BP started, I watched catchers going to warm pitchers up, getting some work in with their receiving. I watched infielders doing some pick work, some pick routine. I didn't quite get all of it. I'm going to go through that tomorrow, kind of put that process at. I watched outfielders throwing up against the wall, long tossing indoors. And I get it. I mean, nobody wants to log. You guys would rather be back where I am, right? Throwing outdoors, 55 degrees. Our guys are freezing. You guys are in tank tops. I'm not complaining about this. I was just telling them at my table, we will host 5 to 6 teams from Illinois and Iowa in the next 3 weeks. And they'll all come down. And we're the top of Mississippi. So just like Cole and them came down, we're the first games that they'll play a lot of the times because we're the top of the food chain, and then they just make the swing to Mississippi and go back home. Well, they all want to go, hey, coach, can we get another hour for BP, take some extra ground balls? We haven't been outside. So I get it. I understand. But whatever you're dealing with, that's fine. But there was a lot of things going on, a lot of moving parts, okay? And what I liked about it is there's your chance. There's your plan right there to become a better infielder. There's your chance. There's part of your plan that Coach McCoy, Coach Spatty put for you to become a better hitter, to get some work done while I'm in the middle of my at-bats, not for another four guys, whatever that case may be. That's part of your plan. That's part of the daily plan. So how you take that upon yourself individually to say, you know what, this is part of, it's easier for upperclassmen, right? You've been through it. You understand. If you don't get it, you're usually not upperclassmen very long, right? You don't make it that long. You can just shovel in the next group of guys that will do it. All right, but you upperclassmen get it. I have to do this. All right, but that selfishness is what it takes to create value for yourself, which in turn impacts us positively. So, yes, I saw that going on, and I like that. And so, football fans in here. We did the Buffalo Bills football fans in here. Now that Eli's kind of gotten around you guys and gotten into the Bills, we kind of Bills fans too back home in Mississippi. However, in the Southeast, college football is king. I hate to tell you. And the Selby household rolls with the Tide. All right, so Coach, you didn't go to Alabama. No, I didn't. But my claim to Alabama is I was born and raised for 4 years in Alabama. So I get to claim the University of Alabama, plus I like being a winner. So I claim Roll Tide in our house. But if for those of you who know anything about Alabama football, Nick Saban, their head coach, is one of arguably the best college football coach of all time. And he is. And I'm not saying that because I like Alabama, because he really is. And he runs his program with a simple process. He runs his organization, which is really complex, with a simple process. And this is part of what we teach. And it's like, so you'll understand when I talk about the daily work that you guys do, how important it is to focus on yourself at that moment. He says, don't think about winning the SEC championship. It's a little excerpt from what he said. Or in your case, the MAC championship. For us, it's the MAC championship as well. Or even a national championship. We talked about, we could do lots of great. Don't think about that. I'm fine. I'm going to contradict everything Coach Morrow and Coach McCoy said. I don't want you to think about that. I just want you to focus on this drill, this play, this moment where your feet are, and the rest will take care of itself. That sounds simple, right? But you have to buy into the fact that what I'm doing right now, and again, we can go back to the one-handed drills and the value of one-handed drills. I love to talk hitting. Some of you guys I've hit with, and I would love to talk hitting for hours on it. But what you're doing, that plan, comes with a reason. There's a reason that we're giving you that as coaches, okay? But I don't need you to focus on that. If I do this, and then we're going to look at this championship. No, that you just focus on what you're doing right there. I watch pitchers doing work on their own. Obviously, you guys have a personal plan, right? Where some of you guys are working on pickoff moves, some of you guys are long tossing, some of you guys are working on pitches into the concrete wall, right? Some of you are running some sprints, some of you are doing some foam rollers, whatever the case may be. That's your plan. And how you attack that plan individually creates value for yourself. Okay, pretty simple stuff. So what I'm asking you is, if the plan's to execute X, and this is what I tell our guys all the time, your plan's to execute X, but let's execute it till we don't get it wrong. What does that mean? Well, Coach, and so you guys probably won't have to deal with this as much as we do. Eli's been around our program long enough to see the differences in the high end and the low end of junior college baseball. So getting our guys to execute a hit and run and just hit a ground ball to the backside is not easy. Some guys just can't handle the bat. So how do I make them do that when I just want them to execute a backside ground ball? They keep working on it. And we just keep working on it until we can't do it wrong. Okay, that's the theory I'm talking about, improving yourself. All right, so I told Eli I wouldn't talk about this. He Snapchatted me a couple. And I'm sorry, parents. My son won't text me. He won't answer a phone call. He'll send me a Snapchat when he needs some Venmo, needs some money. He'll respond to me on Snapchat. So I have to have Snapchat just so I can talk to my son. He's 15 out of the way. And so, but he texted me the other night. So him and some of the guys were hitting. And he just, I'm here. I'm stressing over my season. I'm trying to figure out some things going on. We got everything going left, right, everywhere. And he's like, oh my gosh, I'm garbage. It's 10:30 at night, or it's actually a little bit later for him. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, oh, I'm in here hitting right now, hitting on this machine, I can't hit anything, it's garbage. I'm like, that don't make any sense. What are you? All right, so I had to stop what I'm doing. Thanks, Eli. I'm in the middle of it. I'm trying to get this stuff done. I'm trying to get my practice plan ready for tomorrow. You're telling me you're garbage. What are we talking about here? He said, well, I'm not hitting very well. I said, well, what's your plan? What are you trying to accomplish in the cage? Nothing, I'm just hitting. And all I could think of is, well, why don't you just go grab a bat, stand in the parking lot, and just swing? Because if you don't have a plan to execute anything, you're not getting anything out of it, right? I'm just swinging the swing, right? So you have to have a plan. Guys, if you want to throw harder, what do? You throw, right? If you want to get stronger, what do? You lift. If you want to hit better, you hit. I mean, it's real simple. But you have to have a plan each day to attack. Say, Eli, what's your plan? I'm just hitting. Well, let's go out in the parking lot and swing. I mean, that's the same thing. Or you could go up there with some kind of approach. And let's say, you know what, I'm going to hit every one hops to the shortstop and try to accomplish something and try to better myself, create some value in my swing or some value for my skill set, which in turn impacts my team, right? Because if it's a better Eli, or if it's a better Vinny, or if it's a better Jake, or whoever, then it's a better Niagara, right? All right, so no more garbage. I mean, because you got to have a plan when you do something. So that's plan X. Whatever plan X is, let's just go execute that till we can't get it wrong. So, number one, you have to have goals. You have to, but more importantly, you got to have a plan to attack each day to make those goals a reality. All right, number two, you have to have the discipline and focus daily to take those plans and execute them. All right, the key words being discipline and focus, right? How easy is it to continue to focus when you're tired, you've eaten, there's other things going on, I got practice tomorrow morning, I don't want to hear Coach Selby speak another 20 minutes, right? I'm not offended, I get it. I coach college kids every year, I get it, all right? But the key words here, discipline and focus, I'll go back to Manny. Manny could have easily had some James Brown swings, right? He could have easily just shifted the machine over to the center of the plate, raised it up a little bit, and just back leg balls for 20 minutes. Never did. Not one time. He was disciplined because he knew 75 to 100% of the time when there was guys in scoring position, that's the pitch he had to hit, and he was good at it because he had a plan to execute that plan. It took discipline to just stick with what he was doing. Okay, so, you know, again, I go back to Eli's Snapchat. right? And part of this whole, and Eli and I, we have a lot of mental warfare. You know, that's, I think that's why he's 14 hours away from me. So I pick on him a little bit, talk about what we talk about, but I tell our guys this all the time. How many of you feel 100% every day? 100% mentally, 100% physical. How often do you feel that way? It's rare, correct? But are you expected to be good when you're 80%? Absolutely. So where does that come from? It comes from discipline and focus. I mean, so I tell Eli all the time, he's sick of hearing it. I tell our guys, they're sick of hearing it. You have to be good when you're 80%. All right? The best thing I get to do as a recruiter when our freshmen come in, I can't wait because they're excited. First meeting of the fall, they're sitting in there, they're ready to go, coach, when we get out of the field, coach, we're winning 4-1s. They can't wait. Guys, I'm so excited you're here. I hope you got better over the summer, because if you're not, you're not going to be ready to go. And then the next thing I tell them is like, you know what, 3 weeks from now after practice starts, you ain't gonna like it so much. That's the reality of it. Six days a week, every day, you're like, there's a game you play in your mind. My arm's dead. My legs are wobbling. I'm not as in shape as I was. I didn't realize I had to get up to go to 6 o'clock lifts. I didn't realize I didn't have the 2 hours for homework. When am I gonna get to go out? And then it happens to everybody. That's when the discipline and the focus kicks in, because everybody feels that way. But those who can stay disciplined to continue to execute those plans are the ones that normally are the ones that impact the team the most. Okay, discipline and focus being the big key there. And usually as a coach, like I just said, the level of discipline is usually correlates exactly with how much you're going to impact the team positively. Right? Doesn't mean it's for everybody. Some guys come in here, you know what, coach, I'm good doing what I'm doing. That's fine. But nobody can make you do that. This is an individual choice. But if you focus on yourself on those drills and take the discipline to do it every day, especially the days you don't feel good, especially the days you come off a road trip, I do not want to do homework. I do not want to go to class early. I do not want to do this. Those are the days you have to. Because I promise you, Manny felt like that a lot of times. He played all the time, and he had a lot of hits, and there was a lot of left turns he was making, so he was running the bases a lot, right? So he was tired all the time, but he showed up every day to do the same thing over and over. I can't tell you how much that impacted people play with. So not only do you have to have goals and you have to have plans, more importantly, but you have to have the discipline and focus each day to accomplish those. All right, quickly, because I'm getting close to the end. Here's the key. Not only do you have to have those plans, you got to be disciplined and focused, but you got to be willing to change those plans when the situation calls for it. How many guys, pitchers in here, were the number one starter on their high school team? How many of you guys are number one starters now? And it's no offense. I'm just saying that's the reality of what we do, right? Our guys that are moved from where's Liam? All right, Liam, you were junior college, right?
Yes, sir.
Position player.
Pitcher.
Did you ever play a position?
For 3 weeks, and then okay. I got shifted over.
You made a transfer, right?
Yes.
Changed positions. Okay. I'm just guessing. I thought I heard that one time. All right. So my point: situations change all the time. All the time. Maybe the weight room's not working, or maybe my throwing program's not working. Maybe this band work is not working. Maybe I need to alter my plans. More importantly, maybe I got a position change. What if I'm asked to do something different? What are you going to do? Does that change your discipline and focus and increasing the value for myself? It shouldn't. That's an individual choice. But what you should do is alter your plans to adjust to that. Now I will talk a little bit about myself here, but this is nothing grand. I played my last 2 years. I got drafted after my senior year. So I was a senior sign. I played my last 2 years of Division I ball at Southern Mississippi. And I hit it pretty good this senior year. But my theory was drive in more than let in. So I was a shortstop at Southern Miss. Yeah. So I was not a very good shortstop. But that's where I defaulted at Southern Miss. Okay, I was a shortstop. So when the Red Sox scout came in my office or my house and sat down and said, hey, Bill, we're going to send you out to Elmira, New York in the Penn League, you will not play shortstop. Okay, I'm turning you as a second baseman. Cool. My plans immediately, I'm going to be the next second baseman of the Red Sox. Okay? That was my plans. That was my hopes, my dreams. 3 weeks into my season at Elmira, New York, we have 1/3 base. He goes down with an injury. I'll never forget this as long as I live. It's 30 years this year. Our manager, Dave Holt, at the time, who I mistakenly called Coach Holt the first time I met him coming out of college, that quickly got me scolded and a fine. I learned quickly to call him Skip or Holty or something else. But he stands up in the middle of, after our third baseman goes down, after our game, he stands in there and goes, can anybody here play third base? I can. I'll do it. So the next 3 weeks, I played third base. I haven't played there since I was probably 16. played third base then, I instantly increased value for myself just because I was willing to change the plans that I had for myself, right? So move along 3 years later, I'm in Boston. Rookie year, I'm in Boston. Same thing happens about halfway through the year. One of the bench coaches, Tim Johnson at the time, comes to me and says, "Have you ever played outfield?" What do you think I said? Yes, sir. Absolutely. I'm in a Red Sox uniform, Big League uniform. Yes, sir. I play the outfield. Any of y'all know Jim Rice? Jim Rice, Hall of Famer for the Red Sox. He was our hitting coach then at the time. He broke in my first outfield glove. 3 days later, after he broke it in, I played left field. So what did that do for my value? If I just be willing to change, it increased my value, right? Instead of just being, "Oh, I'm going to just be streamlined, I'm going to do this, I can't change, I'm going to stick with this." No, I just say, "Hey, look, I can do it." So fast forward, I was telling this to Chaz, I think, the other day. We were talking about pitchers. At 30 years old, I'm in Cleveland. We're rolling along. Cleveland's still kind of in their heyday, still got some superstars there. I didn't play much, bench guy. And we're kind of making a run in our division. Two catchers on the roster. Some of you may know Pat Borders, some of you may not. Sandy Alomar. Bench coach Grady Little, for you Red Sox fans, Grady Little was our bench coach at the time in Cleveland. He comes to me and says, "Selby, can you catch?" What do you think I said? Yep. I did when I was 12. I said, "Well, we'd like to teach you to catch, just in case, to be an emergency catcher, in case we make the playoffs. That way, if somebody gets hurt, we can throw you back there until we can get a guy out there." Let's go. For 2 weeks in the middle of the season, I'm going down the bullpens, and I'm catching CC, and I'm catching Chuck Finley. I'm learning how to catch right there in the big leagues, right? Blocking, throwing, all this stuff. It's the best thing ever happened to me. Then every year after that, I got to go to spring training with the catchers and pitchers. Catch Kerry Wood, Greg Maddux, all kind of guys. It was awesome. Then I'd break off in the third when the infielders got there, and I'd go back doing that. But I created value for myself because I had that in my back pocket too, right? So the willingness for me to change. Now, I never caught. I caught in spring training games. I said, "Hey, Selby, why don't you go to the backfields and catch CC for an inning? Let's go." You know, and he didn't want to pitch against eight ball guys because if you threw it in the zip code, they were swinging. And so usually I got lit. But I created value for myself by just the willingness. And I can assure you this, as sure as I'm standing here, if it wasn't for that willingness to change my plans of self improvement, just say, "You know what, I'll do it. I'll make this adjustment to make myself better and add value to who I am," which in turn makes Cleveland a better team because they can keep a lefty off the bench there and not go get another catcher and take one of their bench hitters off the bench, then I'll do it. But if it wasn't for those chances to change and make those changes I made to play different positions, I promise you I wouldn't last as long as I did. I was a very, very average second baseman. That doesn't get you very far. You've seen some second basemen in the big leagues. I played with a good one in Alomar. And so the point being was the fact that I could do that kept me around the game a lot longer than I should. So not only do you need to make plans, set goals, especially make plans, but be disciplined and focused, and then you got to be willing to change when you need to. Who knows when you need to? Coaches will let you know that. Lastly, the last thing about this, and this I'm about ready to close. All of these plans, all these goals we set for ourselves individually. Now I'm telling you to be selfish, guys, but conditionally. Remember that, conditionally. The discipline, the focus you need each day when you're doing your drill work. And let me go back and tell you this. When we do our practice plans, I had this very discussion with our guys 4 days ago. How long do you think it takes to do a practice plan? Anybody got an idea? 5 minutes, 10 minutes?
A couple hours,
maybe a couple days, maybe a couple of meetings with your coaches to figure it out. All right, so it's not an easy task. Why do you think that is? Because we're all trying to put a plan together for each individual, so you create value for yourself, which in turn does what for us? Impacts us positively, right? Correct. Right? So when we make these practice plans, I want you to hear this. I don't know if Coach McCoy's ever heard this. I told this to our guys the other day. When we make our practice plans, and I've got you guys doing this over here while we're going live, and got these guys doing this, we're assuming one thing. You know what we're assuming? That you're going 100%, right? Have you ever made a practice plan and said, "You know what, if my guys give me 50%, I'm good"? We're just assuming you're going hard all the time, right? All right, so that's an individual choice you make each day when that plan is given to you, or the plan you designed for yourself off the field, that you designed for yourself, that's your choice of how hard you go, okay? So that's a challenge to you. So lastly, all of these things, all these goals, all these drills we do, all this to create value for ourselves, with the discipline, the focus to do it daily, every day, and then adjust at the last second when we might have to. It's got to be done within a team concept. How is that? Just know the next time you do the one-handed drill sitters, for you guys that don't like it, because I got a lot of my guys that hate it. And I have to sit down, guys, you realize why we're doing one-handed drills? You realize you can't even pick that barrel up with two hands because you're not strong enough. And as you get better with this, your barrel's going to – I just go through the whole thing. I said, but you getting better with this drill makes our team better, right? The arm care you guys, you pitchers do after you've thrown, bouncing the driveline ball off the trampoline, the running you do, that makes you better, which in turn makes who better? The team better, correct? So when you can focus on yourself individually to do what you're supposed to do at that moment, without anybody telling you, I need you to do this, you've just made your program better. And that's my challenge. That's my challenge for my guys in Northwest every day. If you can do that, the rest will take care of itself. I believe exactly like Coach Morrow said. What I saw in there was exactly what Coach McCoy told me on the phone the other day. I saw a talented group. I saw a good family in there. Guys that get along, guys that have energy in a situation where you've taken some conditions that aren't favorable. I'm not knocking people's facilities. I'm not, but I felt the same thing you felt. The first thing I thought as a hitter, like, man, I can't see in here. I'm going to go face Jake, and he's throwing up there 90-92. I just hope he doesn't hit me, you know, because I can't see it. The same conditions you're taking, but you're still getting in there getting work done, right? There's a lot of ability in this room. There's a lot of positivity. And I'll tell you this, and I didn't have this written down, but I'm going to tell you this. I got a couple of stories from a couple of my players that I want to talk to you about boundaries real quick for a finish. I just added this in. Okay? This is just an add-in. Okay? And Cole knows one of the guys. The lefty you face, don't foul. So here's a lefty that Cole faced. He's, what, 6'5"? You've seen him? You saw him his freshman year or sophomore year? Freshman year. Got him out of high school, 84, 86. And this is about boundaries, and I'm going to teach you what I think about boundaries. 86, 88, we thought, 84, 86, I don't know, 6'6", 6'5", we thought, if we can steal him away from Memphis, we just got a gym. Right, by the time we got him, he's 90-92, he's lanky, you've hit off of him, it's not a fun AB. And imagine getting like that. If it comes in there that year, mows through the league, third round of the draft calls, they call to see if you take $800,000. Nope, not taking it. Okay, you're betting on yourself, I get it. So what he does, he signs with Ole Miss. Ole Miss, 45 minutes down the road. Everybody in Mississippi guys wants to go play at Ole Miss. You know how many can? One. Yeah, that's just the next. So he signs with Ole Miss. His buddy's at Ole Miss, doesn't develop, hurts his arm. He has second thoughts, right? His second thoughts are, man, I don't know if I'm going to get developed there. I'd like to come back and see if I can make some money in the draft. He gets out of his contract, or gets out of his scholarship. Of course, I don't say ban, that sounds bad. They bar him from signing with another SEC school, which I fielded 5 calls the day he said he was leaving. Wouldn't let him do it. So he commits to Oklahoma that day. He comes out, pitches for us, COVID gets him. He's 4-0. Eli saw him pitch that year. What, 15-1 that season? He's won 4 of them. He's set 90-95. And it's from here, and it is filthy. Third round of the draft, there's only 5. Remember that COVID year? 5 rounds of draft. Everybody complaining they don't have any money. They called him in the 3rd round. Eli went to his signing party. He had a big signing party, the whole shebang, all that stuff. They offered him $30,000. Would you take $30,000 to go in the 3rd round? I'm going to Oklahoma. Goes to Oklahoma. Lights it up. Falls great. Up to 96. Calls me one day. Now, he's worked out where he's left there. He's back in Memphis. But the story I'm going to tell you is about the boundaries he set for himself. So he calls me one day, and they get some tough luck from me. So he calls me one day and said, Coach, man, I touched 97. Awesome. Man, that's great. He said, man, I hope I can pitch up to 97 this spring. And I just sat there for a minute, 30 seconds goes by, and he goes, Coach, you still there? I said, yeah, I'm here. I'm just still trying to figure out this 97 thing. Well, man, I touched 97. It's hard. I said, so you set your goal at 97. You're 3 points from 100. You can't just say, I'm going to throw 100. Aren't you limiting yourself? Well, I never thought about it that way. Well, if you set your goals for X, and you've already accomplished that goal, you kind of undershoot. Set it for 100. If you throw it 98, then you've already maximized, right? So he learned the hard way that what I think about these boundaries that we put on ourselves. All right. So I got another guy that plays first base, DH, more of a DH at Ole Miss, and he is the epitome of Ole Miss. He grew up Ole Miss. His parents got a house in Oxford. He's from the Delta, Mississippi. And he turned down four-year schools to come play for us because he wanted a route to Ole Miss. His name's Ben Van Cleve. Y'all watch him. He's a big gorilla, and he does this, and that's his nickname. And big kid, hits, got a lot of pop. 2 years plays for us, kills it. Last year hits 17, 18 home runs. Gets offers by three Division I schools. He waits. I'm going to go to Ole Miss. Awesome. Ole Miss comes along. Can he hit here? Yeah, he can hit there. He's okay at first base, but he can hit there. There's no doubt. I said, but he's free because he's a high academic kid, and his parents have a house in Oxford Hill. And if you just told him you could wash Coach Bianco's car, he'd come play for him. Sure enough, they said, look, you can come walk on. He gets there. He's excited. He couldn't, Eli would tell you, he lives, breathes Ole Miss, the Grove, and everything about Ole Miss. Called me one day last spring, or his junior year of the spring, and we just finished batting practice on the field. They were getting ready for a midweek game. He goes, hey, Coach Selby, I just want to call and say thank you. I said, what for, Ben? He said, oh, man, everything you've done for me, because he would come back, him and another kid that plays at Leatherwood played for us, and they would come back and hit some days during the week, and we just enjoyed that time, spent a lot of time together in cage. He said, man, I just want to thank you for everything. I said, man, you're welcome. I mean, what do I owe you, a steak dinner? Tonight my dream came true. I'm like, what's that? He said, I'm in the starting lineup for Ole Miss tonight. My dreams, I feel accomplished. That's my dream. This is my dream to start for Ole Miss. I just sat there again. I gave him the dog collar treatment to sit there. He's getting ready for VP. He's like, Coach, you still there? I said, I'm here. I'm still trying to figure this dream thing out. He said, well, yeah, I mean, you heard what I said. I said, that's it? That's all you got? Your dreams to be in the starting lineup for Ole Miss one day? I mean, you don't have plans of, like, making an all-SEC team or playing a professional ball? I never thought about that. I said, well, see, you limited yourself. You're limiting yourself. Don't limit yourself. You might as well sit there. I want to be the next big league first baseman. So I tell you this, as a sidebar, I just went off the track to tell you guys this. You're the only ones that puts limits on yourself. You control the destiny of this group. Doesn't matter who you're playing, you control yourselves. I saw a talented enough team in just the 4 hours I was there with you guys the other day that can be heck of successful. But you can't think of, oh, well, who we're playing here, who we're playing this. You take care of yourselves, and then you guys are going to be all right. I'm excited about what you got this season. The philosophy I gave you tonight, again, I'm not rewriting anything. It's simple. It's logical. But it makes you focus on what you're doing at the task at hand, where your feet are in that moment. When you do that, you make for a better program. Personally, I'd like to thank you for letting me come to practice. That's cool. I love my baseball rep. I want to be around it. If y'all have me tomorrow, I'll stand and lean on that wall and hold it up for another 3 hours and watch what y'all do. It'd be okay with that. Just to be a part of it, because I feel as much a part of the program as y'all did at this point. So. Thank you for that. Thank you for letting me be a part of your program for a few days. Thank you for your support of this program. As a coach, I can speak for Coach McCoy and Coach Spatty right now. It's important to have that these guys have somebody other than us tell them we believe in them. You know, it's important for us to have a group that says, hey, you know what, guys, I'm all there for you, and you guys can do big things, and I'm just proud to be here tonight. Hopefully you got something out of it from old coach, Virginia College coach, that'll help. If not, I still thank you for letting me be there and be a team. Okay.
So two real quick things. A few years ago, we had Eric Wedge, who's a former Major League manager, and now is the coach at Wichita State, where he won a national championship as a catcher, and he spoke, and we did a couple questions at the end, and the first question was, who was the best hitter you ever saw in the major leagues? And he said, Manny Ramirez. Hands down, not even close. He's not even close. He's the way he approached the game, attacked the game a little bit. Wedgie played with him, I think, in Boston. Came up from Boston with him. Jeff Datz, who managed the Bisons in 1998-99, we tried to talk him into it. The end of 99, we were around 500. I think we were 71 and 72 or something. And we had one game left, and we were, come on, Datsy, let's let Bill Selby play every position this game. He's done it. He's played every position. He'll pitch the ninth, he'll go in, he'll play third, go to second, the whole thing. Datsy's just an old-school baseball guy. He just didn't think, he didn't like the gimmicks. And he's, man, I don't want to be below 500. If we can win this game, get to 72. So he could volunteer to play everything. We tried with Datsy. He just he wouldn't do it. How about another round of applause for Bill Self? So again, on behalf of Niagara University, I'll echo what Bill just said. Thank you to everybody for your support of the program and the university. Thank you to the moms and dads for trusting us with your sons to come to the university. It's great to have them on campus. As Rob McCoy talked about, they are excellent students and excellent athletes. They're an ambassador for the school everywhere they go. We are very proud of them. Give them one more round of applause for the team. All right.